Hello and welcome to Easy Motion Studio video tutorial. This tutorial will cover the steps needed when starting a new project up to the drive setup. Easy Motion Studio works with projects. Each project is a collection of one or more applications. Each application is a complex structure containing the configuration files for the drive and motor, the motion program and an extensive set of tools for monitoring or troubleshooting the TML program or the drive and motor behavior. After opening Easy Motion Studio, the first step is to establish communication with the drive. To do that, we go to Communication menu and select Setup. The communication setup consists of selecting the proper channel type, the CAN protocol, the port to be used, baud rate and access ID of the drive. In our case, the I/O board used in this tutorial is equipped with a small USB to RS-232 adapter, so we are going to be using the RS-232 channel, and therefore the only configuration I have to do is to select the proper COM port. Easy Motion Studio will detect all the available COM ports, so you have to select the proper one. In my case, it's COM port number 5. When you are pressing OK, Easy Motion Studio will start to communicate with the drive, and if everything goes well, you will see the message online. You will also see the access ID of the drive connected to the Easy Motion Studio, the serial number and the firmware. Now we can open a new project. This also means that we are going to open a new application. And since the application is basically a configuration of the drive and motor, we are going to select first the access ID of the drive connected to the PC. In our case, it's number 6. And then we are going to define the setup data based on one of the existing templates. It is important to note that while the drive are universal, which means they can control all type of motors and can be interfaced with different type of sensors, all this configuration is done mainly by the software. That's why it is important to select the proper template. In our case, we are going to be use an IPOS 4808 VX CAN board, connected to a small brushless rotary motor which is equipped with an optical incremental encoder. Therefore, we have to select from the IPOS drive IPOS 48VX CAN brushless rotary motor incremental encoder. After opening a project and before you are able to program the drive to perform various tasks, you have to configure and validate the actual setup of the drive and motor. This can be done by selecting Setup and clicking on Edit button. Two new windows will open, one for drive setup and one for motor setup. The fact that the motor setup is in foreground indicates that it should be handled first. The motor setup consists of filling in the motor data from the motor datasheet, defining the sensors connected to the motor, and finally running some live tests that allow you to validate the functionality of the system. In order to save time and to be able to use the same motor in future projects, you can save the configuration in a user database. Now that the motor and sensor data are in place, we can run some tests to help us double check the values and validate the functionality of the system. The first test is going to be test phase connection. This test will allow us to validate that the motor wires are properly connected to the drive and the connection is secured, that the motor winding is in proper working order, and also that the drive power stage and current measurement are working properly. This test, just like pretty much all the other tests from the motor setup, is intended to be run with the motor disconnected from the load. And since this test is going to apply voltage to the motor, the default current value is half of the nominal current of the motor. When everything is ready, we press the start button. The drive will energize the motor, some small movement will be noticed, and then the test result will be displayed. The test is passed when the sum of the currents through the motor is equal to zero. When the test is done, we click close button and move to the next test. The number of motor pole pairs is a critical parameter of the motor vector control. While it should be mentioned in the motor datasheet, in some cases, it is not so obvious. The next test will allow you to identify this value. This test requires both the user attention and intervention, and it implies that the user can clearly see the motor shaft. Upon running the test, the motor shaft will be aligned in a certain position, and a small button called Move will appear. Before you press it, take a look at the position of the rotor and memorize it. Now press the Move button as many times as needed in order for the rotor to perform one full mechanical rotation. When this happens, the test is finished and you need to press the Stop button. Since there is a simple relation between the electrical rotation, number of pole pairs and mechanical rotation, the test will be able to accurately determine the number of pole pairs. In this case, the small motor we have has only two poles, meaning only one pole pair. Please keep in mind that because the test relies on the user input, there's no way for the drive to differentiate between a good result and the wrong one. So in cases where the motor shaft is not visible, for example, a gearbox is already mounted, it will be up to the user to make sure that the used value is correct. When the test is finished, we press the close button and move to the next one. The next step is to identify the phase resistance and inductance of the motor. The values determined by the test are dependent on the selection made for the motor internal phase connection, star or delta. It is not possible for the drive to determine the phase connection of the motor, and since this parameter is not always mentioned in the datasheet, there are 50% chances that the results will be wrong. Fortunately, these values are only meant as a starting point for the tuning of the drive controllers, and this tuning can be manually adjusted as needed. So in the end, we'll be able to properly configure the drive anyway. When the test is finished, you are prompted to save the new values if they are different from the old ones. Please note that it is very likely that every time you run this test, you will get different results. This is not a problem, as it is within the accuracy limits of the current and voltage measurement from the drive. When you press yes, the test will be finished, and along with it, the tests related to the motor itself. Before we move on to the sensors, you can specify the motor shaft inertia. Just like the phase inductance and resistance, this value is only meant as a starting point for the tuning process, and if you don't have the precise value, you can just select motor inertia is unknown. Now that we have finished with the motor testing, we can move to the sensors. We'll need to validate the encoder and the digital holes. There are two types of tests which can be performed. One that helps us determine if the sensors are connected to the drive and if the drive inputs are properly working. This is the connections test. And one that helps determine the details of the sensors, the number of encoder lines and counting direction and hole configuration. The encoder test connections will not energize the motor like all the other tests so far, but will instead require you to move the motor from outside to basically get feedback from the encoder. We start the test, wait until it gets to step 2, and then manually move the motor shaft. If you see the position counter changing during the test, then the encoder is connected to the drive and the test is finished successfully.
The next step for the encoder is to run detect number of lines test. Based on the number of pole pairs, this test will rotate the motor for one mechanical rotation and will count the information from the encoder. The purpose of this test is not only to validate the number of encoder lines, but also to determine the direction of counting. Beside the number of pole pairs and the number of encoder lines, the direction of counting is also a critical control parameter. When the motor moves positive, the encoder counter must also go positive, otherwise the drive will be unable to control the motor. When the test is finished, we can see the estimated number of encoder lines computed out of the total encoder count for the rotation. For a 500 lines encoder, the drive will get 2000 precise positions of the motor. This is happening due to the internal construction of the encoder, which is outputting two quadrature signals, thus effectively increasing the resolution four times. If during this test the position counter goes negative and the test fails, you can solve it by hardware or by software. By hardware, it means to switch two of the motor phases so that you get the motor to run the other direction when supplied with positive voltage, or you can switch the encoder signals to get the encoder to count positive. By software, you can actually select this option to reverse the encoder counting, and from this moment on the drive will just inverse the information coming from the encoder. There can be some slight variations around the test result. It might not always be exactly 2000 counts, but this is not a problem. However, if the difference starts to be significant, hundreds of counts, then most likely there are problems reading the encoder signals. The first thing to do in this case is to enable the digital filter present on the drive. For the cutoff frequency, a good starting point is 1 over 24, which corresponds to 2.5 MHz. This means that any encoder pulse coming to the drive with a frequency higher than 2.5 MHz will be rejected as noise. The last of the motor sensors is the temperature sensor. Some drives have a dedicated input for a PTC or NTC thermistor. If such sensor is present on the motor and used, its monitoring can be activated here. Beside motor data and sensors, the motor setup allows the configuration of the motor brake if present. In gravitational loads application, the motor might be equipped with an electromechanical brake to prevent the load from falling off if the motor is powered down. Usually, this brake is controlled from a relay in such a way that when the relay is off, no power applied, the brake is engaged. Here, you have the possibility to select an output from the drive to control that brake and also to define some delays as needed. A delay from the moment the motor is energized until the brake is released, the brake release delay, and the delay from the moment the brake engage command is given until the motor can be powered off. The motor setup is finished with the selection of the transmission to load. You can configure the drive and Easy Motion Studio for a rotary to rotary transmission or a rotary to linear depending on the configuration.